Brothers and sisters, before we begin our worship service, Council has the following announcements for you. The offerings this morning is for the work of the deacons, and the offering for this afternoon is for the Canadian Reformed World Relief Fund. And due to the upcoming vacancies for office bearers, by the retirement of Brothers R. Dornbos, Adrian Hamoon, and Conroy Kippers, the congregation is requested to submit names of brothers deemed eligible for the office of elder and deacon, along with biblical reasons, by April the 3rd, 2017. And also there will be a consistory meeting, the Lord willing, tomorrow evening at 8 p.m. Let us lift up our hearts to our God, and as God's people we confess that our help is in the name of the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and from our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Let us sing to God's praise from Psalm 68, stanzas 1 and 2. In Ephesians chapter 5, we read, "Be imitators of God, therefore, as dearly loved children, and live a life of love, just as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us as a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God." With those words in mind, let's listen to the law of the Lord our God as we find it in Exodus chapter 20, and we will respond to the reading of the law by singing from Psalm 70, stanzas 1 and 2. God spoke all these words, saying, "I am the Lord your God who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself an idol in the form of anything in heaven above, or on the earth beneath, or in the waters below. You shall not bow down to them or worship them, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, punishing the children for the sin of the fathers to the third and fourth generation of those who hate me, showing love to 1,000 generations of those who love me and keep my commandments. You shall not misuse the name of the Lord your God in vain, for the Lord will not hold him guiltless who misuses his name. Remember the Sabbath day by keeping it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. On it you shall not do any work, neither you nor your son or daughter, nor your manservant or maidservant, nor your animals, nor the alien within your gates. For in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth, the sea and all that is in them, but he rested on the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and made it holy. Honor your father and your mother, that your days may be long in the land which the Lord your God is giving you. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not give false testimony against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife, or his manservant or maidservant, his ox or donkey, or anything that is your neighbor's. Let's together come before God in humble prayer. Almighty God and Heavenly Father, Creator of all things and Sustainer of the universe, we thank you that in your creation we can see something of who you are. We can see something of your beauty and your grandeur. Who but you, O God, is so great in splendor. And you are the God who has revealed yourself to us in your word as the one true God. But you also are the God who comes near to us. You are not a God who is far away, but a God who cares for this world and who cares for us, who is involved in our lives. We thank and praise you for your love and your grace toward us, that you love us so much that you were willing to send your only Son into this world filled with sin, to live among sinful people like us and even die for us. And we thank you that you are a God of the covenant, that you come to us with your covenant promises, that we are your people for the sake of Christ's sacrifice offered on the cross for us. And so it is only in his name that we come before you, humbly seeking your grace and your favor. We confess, Lord, we do not deserve your love and your goodness. We confess that even though you have made a covenant with us, we often scorn and despise your covenant. We often neglect to live according to it. In fact, Lord, we even deliberately and knowingly disobey your covenant laws. In fact, we are often in love with our own sins. We are selfish people. And so we pray that you would forgive us all of our sins and trespasses, also the ones we did again this past week, even this morning, for the sake of Christ, and remember your love for your people. Father, we thank you for bringing us together this morning as congregation. It is a joy and a privilege to be able to sing praises to your holy name, to listen to your word. And may our time here this morning be to your honor and glory, for you are worthy of all praise and adoration. And so we also ask that you would encourage and strengthen us. As we come here this morning, we all take our own burdens and joys with us, our cares, our concerns, our grief, and our happiness. Will you be our hiding place, a place of safety and protection, where in the shadow of your grace we are kept in safety? For you are our rock and our defender. You are our God and we are your people. Lord, will you be our guide today and always? For only with you as guide can we walk through this life. And so we also come before you with thanksgiving. We give you thanks and praise. Praise to your holy name, for you are good. Your steadfast love endures forever, and your faithfulness to all generations. Will you then bless the opening of your word this morning and also again this afternoon? Will you be with us and keep us close to you? We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. I invite you now to take your Bibles and turn with me to our scripture reading for this morning. We begin in the Old Testament by reading from the prophecy of Isaiah, a portion from Isaiah 13, and then we will also read a few verses from Revelation 18 and Revelation chapter 19. We begin in Isaiah 13. Isaiah 13, verses 9 through 22. The first verse in this chapter tells us that this is an oracle concerning Babylon that Isaiah, son of Amoz, saw. We pick up his narrative in verse 3, verse 9. See, the day of the Lord is coming, a cruel day with wrath and fierce anger, to make the land desolate and destroy the sinners within it. The stars of heaven and their constellations will not show their light. The rising sun will be darkened and the moon will not give its light. I will punish the world for its evil, the wicked for their sins. I will put an end to the arrogance of the haughty and will humble the pride of the ruthless. I will make man scarcer than pure gold, more rare than the gold of Ophir. Therefore, I will make the heavens tremble, and the earth will shake from its place at the wrath of the Lord Almighty in the day of his burning anger. Like a hunted gazelle, like a sheep without a shepherd, each will return to his own people. Each will flee to his native land. Whoever is captured will be thrust through. All who are caught will fall by the sword. Their infants will be dashed to pieces before their eyes. Their houses will be looted and their wives ravished. See, I will stir up against them the Medes, who do not care for silver and have no delight in gold. Their bows will strike down the young men. They will have no mercy on infants, nor will they look with compassion on children. Babylon, the jewel of kingdoms, the glory of the Babylonians, pride will be overthrown by God like Sodom and Gomorrah. She will never be inhabited or lived in through all generations. No Arab will pitch his tent there. No shepherd will rest his flocks there. But desert creatures will lie there. Jackals will fill her houses. There the owls will dwell, and there the wild goats will leap about. Hyenas will howl in her strongholds, jackals in her luxurious palaces. Her time is at hand, and her days will not be prolonged. Then we turn to the last book in the Bible, Revelation chapter 18, verses 1 through 10, and the first five verses of chapter 19. Revelation 18, 1 through 10. After this, I saw another angel coming down from heaven. He had great authority, and the earth was illuminated by his splendor. With a mighty voice, he shouted, "Fallen, fallen is Babylon the Great. She has become a home for demons and a haunt for every evil spirit, a haunt for every unclean and detestable bird. For all the nations have drunk the maddening wine of her adulteries. The kings of the earth committed adultery with her, and the merchants of the earth grew rich from her excessive luxuries." Then I heard another voice from heaven say, "Come out of her, my people, so that you will not share in her sins, so that you will not receive any of her plagues, for her sins are piled up to heaven, and God has remembered her crimes. Give back to her as she has given. Pay her back double for what she has done. Mix her a double portion from her own cup. Give her as much torture and grief as the glory and luxury she gave herself. In her heart she boasts, 'I sit as queen, I am not a widow, and I will never mourn.' Therefore in one day her plagues will overtake her, death, mourning, and famine. She will be consumed by fire, for mighty is the Lord God who judges her. When the kings of the earth who committed adultery with her and shared her luxury see the smoke of her burning, they will weep and mourn over her. Terrified at her torment, they will stand far off and cry, 'Woe, woe, O great city, O Babylon, city of power, in one hour your doom has come.'" And we turn to the next chapter. We read verses 1 through 5. "After this, I heard what sounded like the roar of a great multitude in heaven shouting, 'Hallelujah! Salvation and glory and power belong to our God, for true and just are his judgments. He has condemned the great prostitute who corrupted the earth by her adulteries. He has avenged on her the blood of his servants.' And again they shouted, 'Hallelujah! The smoke from her goes up forever and ever.' The 24 elders and the four living creatures fell down and worshipped God, who was seated on the throne, and they cried, 'Amen! Hallelujah!' Then a voice came from the throne saying, 'Praise our God, all you his servants, you who fear him, both small and great.'" May the Lord bless the reading of his word. In response to this reading and in preparation for the sermon, let's sing together now from Psalm 139, stanzas 11, 12, and 13. The text for the sermon this morning is taken from the book of Psalms, Psalm 137. Psalm 137. By the rivers of Babylon, we sat and wept when we remembered Zion. There on the poplars we hung our harps, for there our captors asked us for songs. Our tormentors demanded songs of joy. They said, "Sing us one of the songs of Zion." How can we sing the songs of the Lord while in a foreign land? If I forget you, O Jerusalem, may my right hand forget its skill. May my tongue cling to the roof of my mouth if I do not remember you, if I do not consider Jerusalem my highest joy. Remember, O Lord, what the Edomites did on the day Jerusalem fell. Tear it down, they cried. Tear it down to its foundations. O daughter of Babylon, doomed to destruction, happy is he who repays you for what you have done to us. He who seizes your infants and dashes them against the rocks. And it is particularly those last two verses which will be the lens through which we will look at this psalm this morning. Congregation of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, I believe it would be quite safe to say that for many of us, if not most of us, the book of Psalms is probably our favorite book in Scripture. Psalms belong to the favorite portions of Scripture. And that's because the Psalms express so many human emotions, sadness, grief, pain, also joy and anger. And so many of us are quick to turn to the Psalms for comfort, for answers when we experience emotional turmoil in our own lives. At the same time, some of the Psalms can also be rather puzzling, can they not? How are we to understand the prayer from Scripture that says, for example, in Psalm 58, "O Lord, break the teeth in their mouths." Or Psalm 55, "Let death take my enemies by surprise. Let them go down alive to the grave." Or Psalm 83, "Let them perish in disgrace." That's really strong language. And then we have our text. "Blessed shall he be who takes your little ones and dashes them against the rock." Is this an expression of sinful revenge? Is the psalmist guilty of worldly sentiments of revenge? Should we just perhaps maybe skip these prayers and these songs, and should we ignore them? Well, brothers and sisters, it's important that we understand also today how the church can sing these songs. And so before we get to our text, let's take a few moments to wrap our heads around this dilemma. Because we believe and confess, of course, that all Scripture is God-breathed, and it is the rule of faith. And so we should grapple honestly with these issues. And so we need to ask ourselves, who is praying for God to destroy his enemies? That's really the critical issue with this, one of these so-called imprecatory psalms, which means to pray evil against. If you were to ask God to destroy your personal enemy, that would in essence mean that you wanted to curse your enemy. That, of course, would be sinful. But if the King of Peace is asking God to destroy his enemies, that's another matter entirely. If the Psalms are merely a record of an emotionally charged prayer of an individual who lived thousands of years ago, the Psalms would be of little value to God's people today. But instead, if we hear the voice of Christ in the words of the Psalms, then the Psalms become much greater in value and grandeur. And this is what gives the Psalms such great value for the church today, because in the Psalms we hear the voice of our Savior. How else, for example, would we be able to sing the words of Psalm 18, where the psalmist says, "The Lord has dealt with me according to my righteousness. According to the cleanness of my hands, he rewarded me. For I have kept the ways of the Lord. I have not wickedly departed from my God. For all his rules were before me. His statutes I did not put away from me. I was blameless before him. I kept myself from guilt. So the Lord has rewarded me according to my righteousness. According to the cleanness of my hands in his sight." We recognize, of course, we cannot say these words of ourselves. We can't make those words our own apart from Christ. We even find it difficult to understand that David could say these words. After all, these words sound like the words of a perfect man. So we may need to be careful then that we do not try to make every psalm or every part of every psalm our own personal prayer according to our changing moods. It is most important that we understand the Psalms the way Christ and the apostles did. When Jesus lived on earth, he often quoted from the Psalms. And he didn't just merely quote from them as if the Old Testament Psalter were prophecy about him. He quoted the Psalms as if they were his own words. For example, when he said, "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit," he was quoting directly from Psalm 31, verse 5. And a further investigation of the New Testament shows us that repeatedly Christ is the I in the Psalms. He is the primary author of the Psalms. The Spirit of Christ was in the psalmist, speaking through them centuries before he already came to earth in the flesh. And when we hear his voice speak in the Psalms, that also gives us the key to understanding these strongly worded curses in Psalm 137. It is only because Christ speaks in this psalm that the church of today can also sing this song, a song of Christ's triumph and victory over his enemies. And that's why I've summarized the text under this theme: the church sings the song of Christ's triumph. And we will consider first who the enemy is, secondly, the victory, and thirdly, our involvement. So we need to begin by defining some terms. Who is the daughter of Babylon who is doomed to be destroyed? Well, for the human author of Psalm 137, it is quite clear the daughter of Babylon is a direct reference to the kingdom of Babylon represented by Nebuchadnezzar and his descendants. "By the waters of Babylon, there we sat down and wept." And we hear in these words the lament of an Israelite exile, one of the captives of Judah, or one of their descendants exiled from Jerusalem, living in the land of Babylon. However, when the psalmist uses the term "daughter of Babylon," he means more than simply the physical kingdom of Babylon in those days. It's clear from the reference to her destruction. She is doomed to destruction. Well, how does the psalmist know this? Well, we find in his cry for her destruction an echo of God's promise to his people in Isaiah 13, which we read together. An oracle concerning Babylon: "Their infants will be dashed in pieces before their eyes, their houses plundered, their wives ravished, and Babylon, the glory of the kingdoms, will be like Sodom and Gomorrah when God overthrew them." And also in the last book of the Bible, we find reference to Babylon. We find there the climax to the history of Babylon when her destruction is pronounced. "Fallen, fallen is Babylon the great." So in the Bible, Babylon is mentioned from Genesis to Revelation. It rises from its rebellious beginnings at the Tower of Babel, and it becomes a symbol of the Antichrist, a symbol of the evil world power that is against God, the hatred against God and his people. And yet, when God required or deemed it necessary to discipline his people, he used Babylon to accomplish that discipline. But he limited Judah's captivity to 70 years. And then the Lord promised to punish the king of Babylon and his nation, according to the prophet Jeremiah, for all the wrong that they had done in Zion. You see, congregation, ultimately all evil will be judged. and that is symbolized in Babylon's demise in Revelation 18. The great city of Babylon will be thrown down, never to be found again. So in Scripture, Babylon represents all that is hostile to God and His people. And that also helps us to gain the right perspective on verse 9 of our text, which speaks of dashing the little ones against the rock. Now, the word here translated as little ones can sometimes also be translated as children or youths or even young men. So the word doesn't necessarily specify age so much as it does relationship. All who are followers of the evil kingdom, children of Babylon, will be dashed to pieces. Now, the daughter of Babylon and her children were certainly the sworn enemies of the psalmist, the enemies of those who sat down and wept by the waters of Babylon. But notice that the psalmist so closely identifies himself with his God that it is completely natural for him to loathe God's enemies, those who set themselves up against his God. He is speaking here under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. He's not harboring a personal grudge. He's not expressing personal vengeance. But he's praying that God would fulfill his word, that God would vindicate his people and destroy those who hate the Lord and his church. It is a prayer that seeks the coming of God's kingdom. So the psalmist here desires God's kingdom to flourish and the kingdom of darkness to fail. That's the same sentiment expressed in Psalm 139. We sang that together. Do I not hate those who hate you? O Lord, all who against you rise, I as my enemies despise. And then we sang, search me and know my heart. See if I from your ways depart. See if there is any offensive way in me and lead me in the way everlasting. See, here is perfect hatred expressed against the enemies of God. The church is echoing God's hatred for evil. This is the church praying that God would put things right. This is the song the church sings to properly give honor and glory to our holy God. Indeed, congregation, we can say this is the church singing of Christ's triumph over his enemies. And so the question we need to ask ourselves, are Christ's enemies my enemies? And if not, do I love the Lord as I should? We'll get back to that question later in the sermon. Before we do that, we need to understand one more thing. The last verse of Psalm 137 speaks of the children of Babylon being dashed against the rock. Now, what does this mean? Again, this is metaphorical language. Because Babylon was not built on a rock, but on an alluvial plain. It was built from brick and mortar. So we cannot fail to see that the rock here is a metaphor for something else. And note carefully that the word is in the singular. In the original, it's in the singular. And just as the word Babylon has a special significance in Scripture, so does the word rock. The Psalms often speak of God being a rock of salvation, a rock of refuge. And the Apostle Paul also in 1 Corinthians 10 clearly links this rock to Christ. There he speaks about the Israelites traveling through the wilderness, and he says they all ate the same spiritual food and all drank the same spiritual drink. For they drank from the spiritual rock that followed them, and the rock was Christ. Nevertheless, with most of them God was not pleased, for they were overthrown in the wilderness. In other words, Christ is the rock who was present with them to supply them with all their needs and also to judge those who tested him and disobeyed him. And again, when we study the New Testament along with the Old, the significance of this rock becomes even more clear. Think of the correlation to Jesus' words in Matthew chapter 21, have you never read in the Scriptures, the stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone? This was the Lord's doing, and it is marvelous in our eyes. Therefore, I tell you, the kingdom of heaven will be taken away from you and given to a people producing its fruits. And the one who falls on this stone will be broken to pieces. And when it falls on anyone, it will crush him. And why will this happen? This happens to those who reject Christ, the rock. The daughter of Babylon and her little ones have rejected the Redeemer of Israel. They have rejected Christ, the rock. And so the curses that come on Babylon the Great are the payment for her sins. She is receiving what she deserves. God will be returning to her the torture and the grief that she has inflicted on his people. So here in Psalm 137, we find reflected the cry of God's people and also reflected God's promise as recorded by the prophet Jeremiah, "May the violence done to me and to my kinsmen be upon Babylon. Therefore, thus says the Lord, behold, I will plead your cause. I will take vengeance for you." And the Apostle John, he heard a voice from heaven saying about Babylon the Great, "Her sins are heaped high as heaven, and God has remembered her iniquities. Pay her back as she herself has paid back others. Repay her double for her deeds. She will be burned up with fire, for mighty is the Lord, God who has judged her." You see, in the end, all the enemies of Christ, they will be destroyed. And so Psalm 137 is also a warning. A warning to all who oppose Christ the rock. Let all the enemies of Christ read their own doom in the destruction of Babylon the Great. Now, where does that leave us, beloved? Where does that leave us? How do we see ourselves singing this prayer of judgment and of Christ's victory? Are people correct when they say there's something wrong with the Old Testament? We should just skip these songs. We can't sing this stuff anymore. Well, the key to this dilemma is found in the word remember. Notice how often there is a reference to remembrance in this psalm. It's repeated a few times. Here in exile in the Old Testament church remembers the destruction of Jerusalem. God's people remember that Babylon enjoyed doing this. The Edomites reveled in the annihilation of the temple. And of course, we can't remove the horribleness of this. We can't make it sound better than what it is. We can't sugarcoat the horror of sin and the reality of the curse. But we need to remember that this is not an individual prayer for revenge, but it is a communal prayer. It is the corporate prayer of the church for God to keep his word. Israel had to be aware that they could not just simply sing this song as an us versus them song, although there is that aspect here, the church versus the world. Israel had to be aware that even in captivity, they had to sing this song against the background of God's promise to Abraham so long ago. You see, the descendants of Abraham were to be a blessing to the nations. And so they knew that their exile to Babylon was not the end of the story. It's not the last word in the story. The Son of God would come into this world to bear the wrath of God, so that not only Israel, but people from every nation, from every language and tongue on earth, could become people of God and might be saved. So this prayer then, in the grand scheme of things, is a prayer for the defeat of the seed of the serpent, for the destruction of evil, and for the ultimate victory of Christ. It's a prayer for God to set the world right. A prayer for the future, when Christ's return will make everything right again. This is what we're praying when we sing this song. This is what we're praying when we ask God, "Your kingdom come." We're praying for the destruction of Babylon and the coming of the new Jerusalem. And we might be tempted to back off from this kind of prayer. Right? Today we're influenced by a society that tells us that evil doesn't really exist. The world is just a place of chance. That's just the way it is. Things happen and you just got to learn to live with it. Deal with it. But that's a lie, beloved. That's a lie. There is nothing right about pain and disease. There's not even anything right about a cat playing with a mouse or a pack of hyenas ripping and tearing at an antelope while its heart is still beating. And there's nothing right about your cancer and your pain and your sorrow. And there's nothing right about your sin or the consequences of your sin. And so there is a need for judgment on evil. And so there is a need for us to sing this song. You see, part of the good news, part of the gospel is God will defeat evil. He will take vengeance on evil in the final judgment. Jesus will avenge take vengeance on his enemies, and he will vindicate his church. But before that day comes, we still live in a world where the reality is that people are murdered, tortured, they are raped, and they are abused. A world in which millions of Jews were herded into gas chambers and hundreds of thousands of babies are murdered in the womb. These are the things that Psalm 137 is talking about. These are the things that the church is asking God to set right. We look for the day when evil will no longer have the last word, and when those who inflict evil will be crushed. You know, in our world, we're easily tempted to look for other solutions. Just vote for the right politician, things will get better. We will eradicate war. We will eliminate poverty. Just unite the conservatives, get rid of the NDP, and everything will be good again. But that's not what God's people look for. We confess that we are looking to God and to Christ to set things right. Do you realize that, brothers and sisters, when you pray, your kingdom come, and your will be done on earth as it is in heaven, you are praying for the complete overthrow of Satan's kingdom and all of his followers, and you are praying for the victory of Christ's kingdom. You are praying that Christ's enemies will be thrown into the lake of fire. To pray for the extension of Christ's kingdom is to pray for the destruction of every other kingdom on earth. And today we still live between those two realities. Christ is coming. This life is not our eternal home. It's not here yet. And so, brothers and sisters, we need to cultivate in our heart a longing for our eternal home. How can we be in exile and still sing the songs of Zion? By remembering. Remember the destruction of the temple and what the Babylonians did. Remember what happened in paradise. That paradise has been lost and Satan destroyed all that what was good. Refresh your memory. May I never forget that this is not where I belong. Let my tongue stick to the roof of my mouth if I do not remember. If I do not set Jerusalem above my highest joy. You know, brothers and sisters, what is the greatest temptation for those who live in exile? It's that you would start to feel at home in your exile. Is that you would find your highest joy in living in exile. It is that you would seek the peace of Babylon and start singing songs for your captors. You see, we so easily forget that we are citizens of the Jerusalem that is above. And when we forget that, that causes frustration. That causes disenchantment. Frustration comes from forgetting your identity. When you have other highest joys, then you are bound to be disappointed. If your highest joy is pleasure in life, or family, whatever, you name it. If your highest joy is other than Jerusalem, you are bound to be disappointed. And so we need to learn to recognize the idols in our life. So often we are worshiping things that may not be worshiped, serving things and the satisfaction of self instead of worshiping God in all the ordinary things of life. But for the citizen of Jerusalem, this is never going to be the life where you can feel completely satisfied, because nothing here on this side of eternity will ultimately satisfy. Oh, if I do not set Jerusalem above my highest joy. And there's the challenge, isn't it? There's the challenge. Psalm 137 challenges us to live in a way that cultivates our desire for a better home. We so easily tend to forget this, don't we? We tend to forget where our true home is. So let's be thankful that we have psalms like this in the Bible that express this longing. Psalms that remind us of our true identity. We are citizens of Jerusalem, not citizens of Babylon. So we need to seek and pursue the longing for above, for the glory of God and His kingdom. And we need to cultivate a sense of our true identity. And how do we do this, congregation? Where do we find our identity? It's right here, in worship. We find it in worship. The only place in Babylon for the exiles to find their identity was when they came together by the waters of Babylon. There they worshiped. And just like the exiles who gathered there, we find our anchor point in worship. And that's why Psalm 137 is a communal psalm. It's a song that's meant to be sung together, with many voices sung as one. We are expressing together, we're expressing our longing. We're singing to each other in worship. Don't forget who you are. Don't forget Jerusalem. Don't forget what God's enemies have done. Remember your identity. The exiles, they had a desperate sense of urgency about this. In a foreign land, far away from Jerusalem, how could they maintain their love for Zion? Only by coming together in worship. What about us, congregation? Do we not have the same need to maintain our identity? We live in a culture that is increasingly hostile to Christianity and to our faith and to our way of life. We need to remember who we are. So when the church is gathered, are you there? Just like the exiles in Babylon. Do you come together to remember who you are? And do you encourage fellow believers to come with you, join you in worship? Are you there to sing the songs of Zion? And do you recognize that this is where our identity is cultivated? Everything that we do in worship serves this purpose too. This is where we hear about the grace of God that enables us to be citizens of the kingdom of heaven. This is where we listen to God's word, which explains us how to live as citizens of the kingdom. And here we sit around the table of the Lord, which gives us our identity. And here we receive the blessing from Him who is the source of our identity. Everything that we do here in worship awakens in us the longing for our true home. Congregation, may we all grow in that experience. May we all grow in knowing who we are. The growing sense that here in worship, in corporate worship, when God's people come together, here is the greatest reality. Here is the nearest thing that we will experience on this side of eternity of what the New Jerusalem is. This is who we are. We are not Babylon, but we are Jerusalem. And so we also need each other. We also need each other. We need each other to experience this heavenly longing, this longing for Christ's final triumph. Brothers and sisters, are you looking forward to that day? Looking forward to that day when everything will be made right. And you can sing with the multitude in heaven, "Hallelujah! Salvation and glory and power belong to our God, for His judgments are true and just." And today, we may sing of the coming victory someday together. We will sing of the final victory. What a day that will be, and may it come soon. Amen. Let's come before God together in thanksgiving prayer. Our gracious God and Heavenly Father, we thank you for the songs you've given us, songs that teach us of the victory of Jesus Christ. We thank you that as individuals and as church community, we never have to seek revenge. We never have to right the wrongs done to us, because we have a powerful Savior and King who is making all things new and making all things right. Lord, help us then to trust in the judgment of our King. Help us to lay aside anger, bitterness, rage, and any thoughts of revenge. Help us instead to seek your kingdom and your righteousness. Help us to trust that our Lord Jesus Christ will one day right all wrongs, that he will vindicate us who trust in him. And so we pray for the coming of your kingdom. May it come in power and glory. And may the kingdom of Satan be destroyed along with all those who hate you and oppose you. May all your enemies and the enemies of your church who are doomed to destruction be cast away forever into the eternal lake of fire. May they be repaid for what they have done according to your word, O God. And in all this, may your holy name be exalted above the earth. And so we also pray for your persecuted church. We pray for brothers and sisters in the faith who suffer atrocities for the sake of their faith in Christ. Father, be near to them. Help them to remain faithful in all circumstances. And we pray that you would relieve their suffering. So we also pray for the continued spread of the gospel, that in this way your kingdom will increase. Will you bless all faithful preaching of your word? Bless all faithful mission work and evangelism. Bless your people who speak about you rightly. May your word, which is powerful unto salvation, penetrate the hearts and minds of many more people so that your church increases and you are glorified. And Father, we pray that we would never become comfortable in our exile, and that we would not become disenchanted either and disappointed with your providential care in our life, no matter what happens to us. And Father, will you be with every one of us, each in our own particular needs? Father, we all struggle with sin. We all struggle with selfishness. We all struggle with clinging too much to this world and not enough to the kingdom of heaven. And so we pray that you would help us, that you would fill us more and more with your Holy Spirit and grant us all that we need to seek your kingdom, to seek its righteousness. And so we pray that your word would work powerfully in us as well, that we would love your word, that we would cling to it, that we would read it every day and absorb it, and that we would also continuously pray for the strength and help of your Holy Spirit in order to live the Christian life on this side of eternity. Father, we pray that you would be with all of us. We pray for our families, we pray for our friends and our neighbors as well. Will you bless the visitors who are with us today? May your grace and mercy be upon all of us, and give us what we need to live in faithfulness before your face. Give us health and strength through our daily work, and bless the work of our hands. We confess that we are dependent on your goodness for all that we need, for body and soul. But we also confess that you are able and willing to give us all things for the sake of Jesus Christ. And we pray then that the day of the Lord Jesus Christ would come quickly, so that all evil would be destroyed, also the evil and rebellion that remains in our hearts. And we ask then that you would continuously strengthen our faith. Give us the grace to serve you faithfully. Help us to submit every part of our life to you and to your holy word, so that your name would be glorified. And we ask this certainly not because we deserve it, but in the name of Jesus Christ and in the power of your Holy Spirit. Amen. You now have an opportunity to thank and to worship the Lord with your offerings, and we will sing afterwards from Psalm 68, stanzas 7, 8, and 12.
Thank you.
Congregation, receive the blessing of the Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord cause his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. Amen.